stand here before you and preach the word of God. Well, I guess I'm going to have to bend forward here to lean in the microphone so you can hear me. I apologize about this morning. If you could not hear me the way I lost my voice. Let's share something with you before I get started here. This evening, Travis has been my best friend for about 3 years. And I tell you what, I still can't get Travis to say anything good about me. I figured this gospel meeting would be the exception. He said, "Yeah, I'll tell you about my buddy." He goes, "Well, we got Ron preaching and we're just going to let him something never changed, but I love him. He's been a tremendous blessing to my life. President Franklin D. Roosevelt said that December 7th, 1941 would be a day that would live in infamy. The former president was referring to a surprise attack on Pearl Harbor, which until 9/11 was the greatest attack on American soil. Infamy is defined as extremely bad reputation, public reproach, or strong condemnation as the result of a shameful, criminal, or outrageous act. So if we wanted to simplify this definition, we could say it's something or someone becoming famous because of bad things. Mm-hmm. Think about that. Infamy. It is a day that will live in infamy. I was looking at different dates and different spots throughout time, and I asked myself, are there indeed other days that we can pinpoint and say that, okay, these are days that will live in infamy? Well, I thought of the place, Sodom and Gomorrah, okay? And I found it interesting that many people that have no religious affiliation at all can still tell you about Sodom and Gomorrah, can tell you about how wicked it was, what took place there. As a matter of fact, we had a term that came into use around the 13th century, and that is the term Sodom. We all have heard Sodom, right? And that's used to describe the wicked and the sinful acts that used to take place in Sodom and Gomorrah. I thought about 9/11. Will that be a day that will live in infamy? America, our country, we sat and we watched the hijacking of four American jet airliners and the destruction of the Twin Towers in New York City, which led to the loss of 2,977 lives. I remember where I was when that happened. And you know what? Some would believe that June 26, 2015, likewise, is a day that will live in infamy. Now, before you go and say, well, he's crazy, but what happened on June 26th? Well, we had an uproar there. This is the day that the American Supreme Court decided to grant the right to marry homosexuals. We're all familiar with that date, right? And quite a few people were upset about that. I tell you, there were rants online. I mean, people were, oh, no, this is wrong. We can't stand for this. We can't stand for this. We can't stand for this. Well, my brothers and my sisters, I have a question for you tonight, and that is, are you surprised? Are you surprised? Like I mentioned earlier this morning, we cannot look out into the world and expect the world to live a better lifestyle than we do live as Christians. And if we are surprised about what's going on, we have to ask ourselves, well, why? Why are we surprised in the first place? We have passages like Proverbs 14:34. It tells us there that righteousness exalteth a nation, but sin is a reproach to any people. My next question then logically would be, what are you going to do about it? What are we going to do about it? You know, the scriptures let us know that a great falling away would happen if we would turn your attention to 1 Timothy chapter 4 and notice verse 1. 1 Timothy chapter 4. And notice verse 1. Here Paul writes, "Now the Spirit speaketh expressly that in the latter times some shall depart from the faith, giving heed to seducing spirits and doctrines of devils." Going on to 2 Timothy chapter 4 and verse 3, here it says, "For the time will come when they will no longer endure sound doctrine." That is, they will no longer hold themselves up against sound doctrine, but after their own lust shall they heap unto themselves teachers having itching ears. But I tell you what, I think that time has come and it's been here for a while. This is in full effect. So I want to make you aware of something while giving you the title of the sermon this evening, and that is, we are behind enemy lines. Talk about this great country, America, and tell you what, I don't want to get ahead of myself because I have a whole point devoted to that. But we look at this country, the land that we love so much, and we ask ourselves sometimes when we look out into society, what is happening? What is going on? Well, we have to remember that we are behind enemy lines. And when you are on enemy soil, there are some things that you need to do in order to make it through certain types of persecution. The first of which is, we as Christians, we need to rally the troops. Well, what do you mean by rally the troops, Brother Sanders? We need to come together. We need to come together. Well, why? Why is it a good idea for Christians everywhere to come together? I tell you what, there's no better time than to come together and embrace unity than through the times of extreme persecution. As a matter of fact, I was looking through some scripture and I found that, you know what, God's people always fight stronger and stronger and stronger at the face of great persecution. Take a look at Exodus chapter 1 and we'll notice verse 12. Exodus chapter 1 and notice verse 12. Exodus chapter 1, verse 12. Reads here, but the more they afflicted them, that is Pharaoh and the Egyptians, the more they multiplied and grew. So Pharaoh tried and tried to stop the growth of the children of Israel, yet they continued to grow. Persecution there. And I'm reminded of Acts chapter 8 and verse 4. It says there, therefore they that were scattered abroad went everywhere, doing what? Preaching the word. Now think about that. With all the persecution that took place in the first century, the beheadings, the being burned at the stake. Have any of you seen that movie Gladiator with Russell Crowe? The Gladiator movie? You know, now here's something they're not going to, you know, tell you about the people that they would throw into these pits and throw into these arenas. Those were Christians. Christians, they would do this too, right? Extreme persecution Christians faced in the first century. Yet, they saw it worth putting their lives on the line to do what? Stay true to the gospel. Not only stay true, to spread the gospel, to share the gospel. I can't help but to ask myself today, how far are we willing to go to share that same message? How far are we willing to go? We need to get back to the word. Why do we need to get back to the word? Because that is the thing that binds our hearts. We sing that song, blessed be the tie that binds our hearts in Christian love. What is that tie? What is it that is supposed to bind us all together? Take a look at 1 John chapter 1 and notice verse 3 there. 1 John chapter 1 and notice verse 3. John says here, that which we have seen and heard declare we unto you, that ye might have fellowship with us. And truly our fellowship is with the Father and His Son. Right? That's where our fellowship is. Okay, then he goes on to say, this then we write unto you that your joy may be full. Again, blessed be that tie that binds our hearts in Christian love. I think about Psalm 133 and verse 1. It says there, behold, behold how good and how pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity. The first thing we need to consider here is behold. Well, that means it's something to be marveled at, right? Mm-hmm. Behold, if I say behold, let me, hey, I need your attention. Look, right? Behold. Have any of us ever watched the Animal Channel, Discovery Channel, any of those channels? And, you know, I'll tell you what, I get a kick out of those little ants that they have on there. You say, man, these ants they're so small, right? But then you see them taking down bugs five times their size. You see them build these tremendous ant hills. You say, wow, look at that. They're all working together. You can't tell me that people outside of our four walls wouldn't look at us and say, man, what's going on with that Church of Christ if we all practice unity? I guarantee you, they would. If that example doesn't work for you, I'll give you another. Last night I was in Oxford, Mississippi, okay? Oxford, Mississippi, watching my Rebels play, okay? And I tell you, it's a beautiful sight. You look around that stadium, you see everybody wearing blue, everybody wearing white, right? And it's 60,000, I want to say 60,660 people were there last night. And guess what? They all were agreed on one thing. Well, what was that? That the Ole Miss Rebels are the best football team in the land, right? We're going to cheer for them. We're going to shout for them. And here's another thing that made me laugh about it. You know, if there's ever a fan that comes in and gets out of line, do you think the rest of the fans are going to support that behavior? If you have one fan saying, boo, you guys suck, well, we're not going to go, yeah, that's right. No, everybody else is going to say, hey, you don't talk about our team like that, right? Again, that unity, right? They're all agreed on one thing. That could, it could be us. It could. Christ prayed for unity, John chapter 17, verses 20 through 21. It says here, neither pray I for these alone, but for them also which shall believe on me through their word, that they all may be one, as thou, Father, art in me, and I in thee, that they also may be one in us. And here it is, that the world may believe that thou hast sent me. That they may believe that I've come because of the unity that they keep and practice. Do we ever look at unity and say sometimes it's impossible? Do we feel that way? As if it's impossible. It's just we can't do it. We can't come together. Too many people have ideas. Too many people, they have opinions. I tell you, everybody has something to bring to the table. And you know what I think about Genesis chapter 11? Think about everything those people were able to accomplish there because they all spoke the same language. Yet when God confounded their speech, work ceased, right? But they were working together just fine when they all were speaking the same language. Well, I tell you what about opinions. We can't be divided over those, and we need to learn. Actually, you know, as Christians, me and a close friend, we were talking about this the other day. We need to understand that it is a person's right to have an opinion. We need to, you know, understand that and respect that. Regardless of if that opinion is wrong, right? That is their right to have an opinion. And we may say in society, well, you know, well, in some countries, a person's opinion is worth $1 million. But I tell you what, well, that's why I'm thankful for the Word of God. You take your opinion, you take my opinion, and you put it next to the Word of God. I tell you, it's worth less than a penny, right? We can't be divided over our opinions. Another reason why we need to rally the troops, why we need to come together, why we need to practice unity. I want you to take a look at what unity has accomplished for others over the last 50 years. The last 50 years. Well, why do I use 50? 50 is a number that we marvel at. Super Bowl 50. 50, I've reached the half century mark. To say that I've been married for 50 years, it is my golden anniversary. We marvel at the number 50, don't we? 50. Okay. Well, in less than 50 years, the homosexual agenda has almost seen itself complete. In less than 50 years. In less than 50 years, the humanist agenda has almost seen itself complete. That is the idea that man is their own God. We don't need a divine creator or divine power. In less than 50 years, the agenda of the denominations is complete. Now, I'm not one to get up here and bash denominations and call people by name because, hey, listen, man, we got some things we need to address inside our four walls. Right, there's a shift, there's a movement going on, and if you don't know, I want to make you aware. You know, it's getting to the point now where you can't tell a Pentecostal from a Baptist. It's getting to that point. You can't tell the difference. They're starting to come together on doctrine, right? All right, we agree to disagree, but we're going to come together and we're going to just come with this big contemporary, this mega church. We're going to practice unity. Well, isn't that what we're supposed to be doing? Amen, Walls. I know y'all looking at me. Amen. That's what we're supposed to be doing. What we're supposed to be executing, again, in less than 50 years. But now this is a two-sided coin. You flip that over and you look at the other thing. Now let's look at the church. Okay, in less than 50 years, what have we seen? Our numbers reduced greatly in less than 50 years. In less than 50 years, we've seen congregations open the doors to instrument and music. We've seen them open the doors to female preachers and women. Don't throw rocks at me. I know you have your place, but we all have roles. But we've seen all of this in less than 50 years. Again, look at what unity has accomplished for others. I'm gonna get off my soapbox here, but I gotta tell all this to you. I was watching a video online of a Muslim said, I think in England, he said, we wanna change Buckingham Palace to a mosque. We wanna change it to a mosque. So a reporter on CNN said, well, if you change Buckingham Palace into a mosque, well, what's going to happen to the queen? He said, she's got two choices. She can either become a Muslim, or she can leave out of the country. I laughed. I said, well, that's her country, right? But how are they accomplishing what it is that they're accomplishing? Guess what? They have a belief system. They're going to be unified on that belief system, and they are going to demonstrate what it is they believe, to the point that other people look at what they're doing and notice them and give them the respect that they want. Church, that could be us. It could be us. That takes me to my second point. That is, we must keep our morale boosted. We must keep our morale boosted. I tell you what, I know it's easy to become depressed. We look at society again, like I mentioned earlier, we look at this great country that we live in and we say, what is happening? What is going on? I can't believe, you know, the state is so bad as it is. You know, we may say things like, you know, I sure pray for this nation. I hope this nation can turn around. How about this one? I pray that something be said or something be done that may touch the heart of someone else. We all heard that prayer before. And something be said or done. But I tell you what, why aren't we saying anything? Why are we doing anything? I think about what Paul says in Galatians 6:10. He says, as you therefore have opportunity, do good unto all men, especially they of the household of faith. I tell you what, opportunity's knocking on the door, is it not? Mm-hmm. I sat in class earlier today, and I liked something that Travis did. Let me grab on a little bit. He asked the children, did you talk to somebody about the Bible this week? I like that question. Well, some said yes, some said no. I said, well, you know, he didn't jump on them, but back here. He said, well, you know, what did you? Well, the conversation was either too short, you know, I didn't have time to bring it up. Okay. And then for the kids that did actually, you know, talk to somebody else about the Bible, what you talked about, and how did it go? I like that he brings that up in class. We should ask each other that question. You talk to somebody about the Bible today. Y'all gonna put some rocks at me here in a minute. I'm gonna move on. But all I can say though is, it's like that song we sing. Soldiers of Christ, arise and put your armor on. I love that song. Put your armor on. We look at the condition of the world today, and I tell you, we're ready to throw our hands up, but have we ever stopped and thought about what the Apostle Paul had to work through? The same things, right? We say, oh, look at people giving themselves over to homosexual marriage. But was this not going on when the Roman Empire was in power? Trust me, it was, okay? Probably even more so than it is today. Did Paul have to deal with people bringing false witness against him? Of course he did. Did Paul have to deal with people talking behind his back? Of course he did. All the things that we could put on the table, Paul could use as an excuse himself. And guess what? He didn't. Think about Lamentations chapter 3, verse 23. There it tells us that his mercies are new every morning, and great is his faithfulness. Think about that. His mercies are new every morning. They're fresh. I tell you what, if we serve a God whose mercies are new and fresh every morning, I tell you what, we should be able to wake up and say, my commitment to you is new. It's fresh every single morning. I tell you, we can. I think about 2 Timothy chapter 2, verses 3 and 4. When I look at this, it lets me know that we have to fight here. We're involved in a spiritual warfare here. We can't be too caught up and involved with the things that are of this world. Here in 2 Timothy chapter 2, verses 3 and 4, it says, thou therefore endure hardness as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. No man that warreth entangleth himself with the affairs of this life, that he may please him who hath chosen him to be a soldier. We have to be focused. We have to be focused. Well, the only way we can do this is with God, right? We can't accomplish this on our own with our own strength.
That's right.
Cannot be too entangled with the things of this world. You know, we got some brothers and sisters that are more passionate about what flag's coming up, what flag's coming down, who's going to get elected into office, who's going to be impeached, who people are going to vote for, gas prices, what else is on the table? Climate crisis. We're more concerned about that. My brothers, okay? Your brothers, my sisters, your sisters, divided over something as silly as that. Well, I can't believe they're going to tell us to take it down. Why does it matter? Why does it matter? Only flag we should be concerned about flying is the flag or the banner of Christ. That's it. Now, don't get me wrong before I move on. There's nothing wrong with pledging allegiance to America. I love America, okay? I'm not trying to go anywhere else. There's nothing wrong with pledging allegiance to America, but could you imagine a society, okay? Or imagine a scenario where everybody pledged allegiance to God. That'd be a place to be. That would be a place to be. Again, I say we must wake up. And the reason that we must wake up is, well, it's going to take me to my next point. And that is, as Christians, we must look forward to our D-Day. We must look forward to our D-Day. Well, what is our D-Day? Well, that's that day of deliverance. We must look forward to it. You know, I believe we've gotten too comfortable. Back home, we are studying Exodus. And I asked the congregation, talked about that king that arose that knew not Joseph, did not recognize Joseph. I said, was it a bad thing that this king came along? Oh, everybody immediately said, yes, it was bad. It was bad, 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 bad. I said, why was it bad? Well, because he made them slaves, right? That's the logical answer. He made them slaves. They went into captivity. They had to endure bondage. I said, okay. Would the children of Israel have perceived themselves to be in bondage before this king came along? When they had nothing else to give, they said, Pharaoh, take us as servants. I said, okay. Keep telling me about it. Tell me some more. Well, Israel didn't have to give up anything when Egypt was selling everything. I said, say again. Israel did not have to give up anything while Egypt was selling everything. So, okay, so you have this man, Pharaoh, or the position of Pharaoh, being elevated, right? You're becoming powerful. You got money, you got land, you got servants. You do some things with that, right? I said, okay, then this man comes. And he makes Israel slaves, okay? He takes Israel out of the land of Goshen. I said, tell me about Goshen. Well, that was the best, that was a prime piece of land, best piece of land. I said, okay, so now I go back to my original question. Was it a good thing that this king came along? One person said, I think I understand where you're going, Ron. I said, okay, what am I trying to say? He said, Israel had gotten too comfortable. They had gotten too comfortable. They had the best of the land. They had everything, right? They had gotten comfortable. I tell you what, if you tell me, Ron, 10 years from now, we're going to move you to a 46-room mansion in a state on a lake. We're going to have it all worked out for you. I'll say, okay, that sounds good. But in the meantime, we're going to give you, let's say, a 16-bedroom mansion here in Columbus, Mississippi. Well, I tell you, I probably won't take the mansion. And then 10 years later, when you say, hey, Rob, you know it's time to leave. We got that mansion ready for you. I'm not trying to go anywhere. Think about that. What did Israel say when Moses led them out? We need to go back. We need to go back. Back to bondage. Back to all the things that they thought they had good in Israel. I say, you know what? I think we're like them. Sometimes we open the Bible and we're hard on people with the Bible. We say, how dare they? We wag our heads. We say, bad dog, right? How could you turn your backs on a God like that? We do the exact same thing. Come on, church. We do the exact same thing. You know, we look at the Bible, we see Jesus, of course, we know that he shows us the Father, but the people, the apostles, the other great people that we can read about, they should show us ourselves. They should show us ourselves. I look at it this way, Matthew chapter 16 and verse 26. It says here that, what is a man profited if he shall gain the whole world and lose his own soul? For what shall a man give in exchange for his soul? That is our most prized possession. Not our money, not our clothes, not our cars, okay? Our souls. Likewise, we have passages like Colossians chapter 3, verse 2. It says here to set your affections on things above, not on things on earth. I mention these passages because, you know, all the things that our Lord and Savior told us not to be concerned with here on this earth, have you ever realized that we can have them in abundance in America? Have we thought about this? Don't fall in love with money. You sure can get it here, can't you? Mm-hmm. Don't fall in love with the material things. You name it, you can claim it if you work hard enough for it. Think about that. All my time in the church, I've never heard anybody say, God, keep us from being covetous. Guard our heart from that. Well, the Bible tells us that being covetous is idolatry, right? It's idolatry. Idolatry, right? That's a sin. We got to wake up, brothers and sisters. We have to wake up. You know, this world has allowed us to believe that America is Israel. And I hate to tell you this tonight, but it's not. America is not Israel. And we need to stop saying that this is God's country. I don't mean to step on anybody's toes. I don't mean to offend anybody. This, my friends, is not God's country. This land has never been God's country. And if you would come to me and step to my face and tell me, well, I want to argue. We're going to argue about this, Ron. I'm going to tell you exactly how I know that it's God's country. Okay, well, let's do it. Let's put it to the test. Was it God's country when the Indians were slaughtered? Was it his country then? Oh, wait a minute. Or maybe you're referring to the time when the Declaration of Independence was penned and we said, okay, well, that's going to be our living constitution, not the Bible. Or wait a minute, hold on. Or was it the time that, African-American slaves were brought over to this country, ripped apart from their families? Oh, no, not there. Well, any of those days? Well, maybe it's because we stamp on our money in God we trust. Let me tell you something. That just looks good, doesn't it? It just looks pretty. This has never been God's country. In the beginning, maybe it was neutral at best. But I tell you what, it's been all downhill since then. This has never been God's country. We need to remember, just like that song we sing, that this world is not my home. It's not my home. It's not your home. I'm just a passing through. My treasures are laid up somewhere beyond the blue. Do you believe that? Do you believe it? Not meant to stay here, to dwell here forever. Take a look at Daniel chapter 2 and verse 44. Maybe this will conclude the thought that I'm trying to convey. Daniel chapter 2 and verse 44. Daniel chapter 2, verse 44. And in the days of these kings shall the God of heaven set up a kingdom which shall never be destroyed. And the kingdom shall not be left to other people, but it shall break in pieces and consume all these kingdoms, and it shall stand forever. Well, how's it going to stand forever? How? It's going to stand forever. Maybe because it's not found by geographic location, right? You can't pinpoint it, put your finger on it like this. It's not a physical kingdom, right? It's not a physical nation. But rather a spiritual kingdom. A spiritual Israel. Yeah, our Lord and Savior said himself, John 18:36, what did he say? My kingdom is not of this world. It's not of this world. I found it interesting too as I was studying for this. You know, if you look over time, if you're into history, you can identify what nation a warrior belongs to by their weaponry. And I found that pretty interesting. You can maybe look at a spear and say, okay, well, this person belonged to this group of people, or maybe a longsword, or a staff, or a shield. I thought that was so interesting. Paul said the weapons of our warfare are not carnal. 2 Corinthians chapter 10 and verse 4. Our weapon is a spiritual one, Ephesians 6:17. The sword of the Spirit, right? So we are identified by our weapon. It should be known to all those across the land which kingdom we belong to. Again, I say this world is not my home. We're just a passing through. We cannot become like those in the world around us. This is why Paul says in Romans chapter 12 and verse 2, he says, be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing. That is the renewing of your mind. This is speaking of an inward change that manifests itself outwardly. Paul tells us that we must stand firm and that we must not be moved, 1 Corinthians 15:58. I tell you what, we need to look forward to our D-Day, our day of deliverance, because great will be the coming for the faithful child of God. I tell you, it'll be a great day. We serve a Lord and Savior that will not forsake us. He'll never forsake us. Ever, okay? Ever. We serve a Lord and Savior that knows those that belong to him. You know, I find it interesting. So many people say, I know the Lord. I know him. You know what? At that day, that's not going to be the question that needs to be answered if you know him. It's whether he identifies you. Does he know you? Great will be the coming for the faithful child of God. And we have to trust, we have to know that Jesus will return to gather us up and take us to that everlasting home with the Father. We have to believe that. We have to believe it. Some people tell me I'm too young. They ain't too cynical to talk about heaven as much as I do. I tell you, if you come back tonight, are you ready to go? Are you ready? I tell you, I'm ready. I seen enough of this world. I'm ready. We've got to believe it. Believe that he is going to stay true to his promises. 2 Peter chapter 3 verse 9, it tells us there that the Lord is not slack concerning his promises, as some men count slackness. When God says it, it's done. He's not slack concerning his promises. So we have scriptures like James chapter 1 and verse 12. You want to take a look at that. James chapter 1 and verse 12. James chapter 1 and verse 12. That's James chapter 1 and verse 12. Blessed is the man that endureth temptation, for when he is tried, he shall receive a crown of life which the Lord hath, here it is, promised to them that love him. He's promised that, right? He's promised that. I'd like to take your attention to 2 Timothy chapter 4. I know it's verses 7 and 8. 2 Timothy chapter 4, verses 7 and 8. I have fought a good fight. I have finished my course. I have kept the faith. Henceforth there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give me at that day, and not to me only, but unto all them also that love his appearing. That is, that they can't wait for him to get back. They love his appearing. In 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verses 17 through 18 is the last passage that I will direct your attention to. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4. Verses 17 and 18. Then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord there, and so shall we ever be. So shall we ever be with the Lord. 18 goes on to say, wherefore, comfort one another with these words. Comfort one another with these words. Are we comforting one another with those words? Are we helping one another keep our aim, keep our vision on that eternal home, on that eternal resting place? Are we doing that? Are we reminded about it ourselves? I know it's easy to get caught looking at the sand like the Israelites did. I understand that. I'm not standing here saying that, okay, there has never been a time in my personal life where I haven't gotten discouraged. We all get discouraged. But we need to be encouraged when we think about the promises of God. We need to be encouraged. Again, we are behind enemy lines, and Jesus said there are some things that we must do. We must come together. We must come together. We must keep our morale boosted. You know, I think it's a sad thing. You ask a member of the church today, are you going to heaven? I guarantee you, they're going to tell you, I don't know. Listen to that. I don't know. Well, should we know? Are you convinced tonight? I don't seem convinced. Are you sure? You sure you're going to heaven? Okay. Hey. We should be confident. We should be confident. We should know. We should know. Soldiers, I pray that I haven't offended anybody tonight. Never my intent to, you know, stand here and step on anybody's toes. Some sermons don't feel good when you preach them. But, you know, it's so much that we look at when it comes to the church, and I can't help but sometimes say to myself, you know, if we only kind of look inwardly sometimes, and maybe look at some of the things that we could address, maybe some of the things that we can change, maybe some of our habits, maybe some of our tendencies, maybe some of our cares, and we could just start there, some of those small things, and try to, you know, perfect or correct some of the things that, you know, kind of distract us in this life. I tell you, I know it would be a great turnaround. It would be a great turnaround. Well, if Jesus said that I have a vessel, let's just call it a vessel, and that vessel is going to heaven, would anybody here want to go?
Absolutely.
Okay, I believe about one person would want to go. They said absolutely. All right. Now, I'm going to tell you something. I love all of you. Now, if Jesus stood here, right here, and said, I've got a vessel that's going to heaven. Do you want to go? If I were at the other end of this building, I would run through you like my name was Marshawn Lynch to get to Jesus Christ, okay? And get on that vessel. I'm trying to go to heaven. That's what we should want to be. Person that would want to go to heaven, I would imagine they'd run forward and they say, listen, here I am, I want to go. Jesus may say, well, hold on, slow down there just a minute. I've got some conditions for you to meet before you can board my vessel. And those conditions are simple. Have you heard the unadulterated word of God? Have you heard it in its simplicity? Do you believe that word? As much as you can believe it, wholeheartedly. I noticed when you were running over here, you had a dirt trail on your shoes. And you know, I keep a clean vessel. We don't allow dirt in here. You gotta clean that off. You wanted to separate yourself from a life of sin and submit yourself to the will of the Father. Are you willing to do that? You wanted to come to repentance. Okay, you say, yeah, I'm ready to do that. Okay, will you confess Christ before men? And will you join to the watery graves of baptism? We could do that. I believe after Jesus made his conditions known, he would then ask anybody that said they wanted to get on that vessel. Do you have the courage? Do you trust me enough? Do you believe me enough? Are you confident enough to meet my conditions? If you're here this evening and you need to respond to the invitation, in any way, please do so as we all together stand.
Bring Christ your broken life, so marred by sin. He